Hello and welcome. Today we're going to be talking about the neurotransmitters in our brain, those tiny little chemical messengers that send information through our neurons to communicate to the rest of our body. We'll also be looking at how does our brain communicate with the rest of our body as well. So let's take a look at the chart of all of the different neurotransmitters that we need to know for psychology class. There are really two major pieces that we'll need to know. What are the main functions of each neurotransmitter? And for some of them, what neurological disorders are associated with that neurotransmitter, and is it too much or too little that causes it? So we'll start here by looking at acetylcholine. And acetylcholine, also known as ACH, is really involved in two major processes. You'll want to remember that ACH is responsible for muscle movement and memory. A way to remember that ACH is responsible for muscle movement and memory is think about when your muscles are sore, they ache. And ACH sounds like ache. The way to remember that it's responsible for memory as well is to remember the disorder that's associated with not having enough of it. If you don't have enough ACH in your brain, you will experience Alzheimer's, which both start with A. So a little alliteration to remember that ACH and Alzheimer's go together. And Alzheimer's is a brain disease that affects our memory. So those are the two major functions of ACH. The next one is glutamate. And glutamate is the main excitatory neurotransmitter. It is involved in a lot of different processes in our brain and in our body. And it is in abundance in many different areas. So the only thing you really need to know is that it is a major neurotransmitter. GABA is our main inhibitory neurotransmitter, which means it helps slow us down. So in an emergency, when your heart is racing, at the end, when you calm back down, GABA is responsible for slowing down those different processes in your body. I like to think of GABA and imagine it as being a stop sign. So imagine a stop sign that has the words GABA on it instead of stop. Both are four-letter words, so hopefully it helps you remember that GABA slows things down the way a stop sign slows a car down. The next neurotransmitter is dopamine. The important thing to remember about dopamine is that it is responsible for pleasure and reward centers in our brain. So doing things like eating chocolate or other activities that you might enjoy are going to release dopamine into your brain. Too much dopamine is the primary cause of schizophrenia, particularly in the frontal lobe area of our brain. Too little dopamine causes Parkinson's disease. And dopamine is commonly confused with serotonin, because serotonin is responsible for mood and happiness. So dopamine and serotonin go hand in hand, but dopamine is more about pleasure and enjoyment, whereas serotonin is more about our mood and happiness. And of course, if we don't have enough serotonin, we'll experience depression. Our final neurotransmitters include norepinephrine, which is our brain's adrenaline, which is responsible for our arousal and alertness. So in an emergency situation, our brain will fill with norepinephrine to arouse the body and mobilize it to protect itself. Endorphins are our body's natural opiates. So endorphins are our brain's natural painkiller. Endorphins are released either in response to pain or in response to vigorous exercise. So sometimes people refer to things like a runner's high at the end of physical activity, and that is because of endorphins. If you remember in Legally Blonde, Elle Woods said, exercise gives you endorphins and endorphins make you happy, and happy people don't kill their husbands. Unfortunately, Elle Woods was wrong. Exercise does give you endorphins, but serotonin makes you happy. And the final neurotransmitter is substance P. And substance P stands for pain. This is the neurotransmitter that sends messages of pain throughout our body. So when you hurt yourself, for example, substance P and endorphins both might be released. One is going to tell your body that you are in pain, and the other, endorphins, is going to try to mitigate that. If you remember from the last video, neurotransmitters are sent through the synapse and attached to the receptor sites on the dendrites of the next neuron. And each neurotransmitter has its own receptor site. So dopamine has its own receptor site, serotonin has its own receptor site, and so on. And each neurotransmitter will fit like a lock and key, fit perfectly into the receptor site on that dendrite for which it is responsible. When drugs or medications are created to help mimic or block neurotransmitters, they are going to look very similar, but not exactly the same as the real neurotransmitter. And they're not always going to react in exactly the same way. A substance that mimics a neurotransmitter is known as an agonist. And so cocaine, for example, is an agonist for dopamine. It doesn't look exactly the same as dopamine, and it doesn't respond in exactly the same way. But many different types of illicit drugs are going to look chemically similar enough that it can occupy those receptor sites, but it might reattach over and over again, or attach and stay there to increase the amount of dopamine that we feel in our brain. This is what makes some of those drugs so highly addictive, because that pleasure center is then activated, and that is where the high that comes with drug use is taking place. An antagonist, and you can think of an antagonist like the bad guy in a story, is what stops a neurotransmitter. So sometimes medications are created that are going to stop a neurotransmitter from acting the way that it normally would. Botulin, for example, the ingredient that is in Botox, is going to be an antagonist for ACH. So if you were to get a Botox injection in your face, it paralyzes those muscles. And because ACH is responsible for muscle movement, it's actually preventing the muscles in your face from moving by preventing ACH from going to those neurons. In larger amounts, botulin causes botulism, which of course happens with things like food poisoning that could cause horrible side effects such as respiratory failure when additional muscles stop working as well. So agonists mimic neurotransmitters and antagonists are going to stop those neurotransmitters. The final thing we'll look at today is how are these chemical messengers sent from the brain to the rest of the body? How does the brain communicate with the rest of the body? And that of course is through the nervous system. So the nervous system is made up of several different components. The central nervous system is our brain and our spinal cord, and that is where these messengers are going to originate. If the message needs to be sent to the rest of our body, it's going to be sent out through the peripheral nervous system. And if you think about the peripheral, like your peripheral vision is on the sides, it is what spreads out from your central nervous system to everything else in your body. In your peripheral nervous system are the somatic and the autonomic nervous systems. The somatic nervous system is also known as your skeletal nervous system, and that deals with voluntary muscle movement. So when you choose to move a part of your body, that information comes from your central nervous system, from your brain, to the peripheral through the somatic nervous system to tell you to move, say, an arm or a leg. The autonomic nervous system, you can think of autonomic like automatic. It's what takes place inside your body automatically. So your heart beating, your food digesting, all your internal organs are being run by your autonomic nervous system. Although automatic, there are different things that can affect the speed at which these processes take place. The sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems take place within the autonomic nervous system to speed up or slow down these bodily processes. So again, in say an emergency situation, your sympathetic nervous system will kick into gear and it's going to speed up your heart rate. It will speed up your breathing. Perhaps you begin to sweat. So there are certain parts of your body that are going to be activated into higher gear when your sympathetic nervous system is activated. Pretty much anything except for digestion, because that's no longer necessary. Once the emergency is over, then your body starts to calm back down, partially thanks to GABA. And as those body systems start to slow back down again, the parasympathetic nervous system is what returns the autonomic nervous system to normal. So your heart rate slows back down again, your breathing returns to normal, and your digestion speeds up back to normal as well. The last thing we'll take a look at today is the endocrine system, because the endocrine system is the hormonal system. And oftentimes our neurotransmitters and our hormones will work together to send messages throughout the body. If the central nervous system uses chemical messengers, the endocrine system uses hormonal messengers. And these are activated by a part of the brain known as the hypothalamus that is connected to the pituitary gland, which is the master gland in our body. These are going to release hormones into our bloodstream. They travel slower than neurotransmitters. And some hormones are very similar to neurotransmitters, like norepinephrine and adrenaline, and others are very different. For example, estrogen or testosterone, we don't have chemical messengers that are the same as those hormonal messengers. But they work together to help our brain communicate with our body in order to function effectively, and that information can then be passed back to our brain to receive messages to allow it to regulate itself. We'll go ahead and stop there for today, and next time we meet, we'll go ahead and talk about the different parts of the brain and what each function is. Thank you so much for watching, and as always, remember, be kind to your mind.